That continues to be a shocking statistic. It seems the prevalence of cancer is either increasing or perhaps we have more reported cases. Which is it? Joining me now is Dr. Gladwell Kiarie. She's a medical oncologist. Thank you so much
for making time to join us.
So what is the case? Are we seeing more cancer cases or are people now aware of what diseases they're struggling with?
Definitely the numbers are increasing, as seen all over the world. In Kenya, cancer is the third major cause of mortality and morbidity. So for a variety of reasons, either because of lifestyle change or probably better diagnosis, the numbers are increasing.
And what demographic is affected mostly?
As said, around 41,000 people are dying each year, and that is about 76 patients per day are dying of cancer. So a huge impact, both economically and socially.
Would you be able to break that down in terms of gender or even economic profile?
Yes, cancers in Kenya are more common in women, with breast and cervical cancer leading. And out of the 41,000 deaths, 23,000 probably are women.
And you have said that this is more often than not a lifestyle-associated disease. Would that be correct?
Well, basically, if you lump cancer as part of non-communicable disease, one would say so.
Right.
And that there are more people smoking, there are more people taking alcohol, probably being obese and eating wrong. But also there is a genetic susceptibility to cancer where you cannot change your risk, but definitely probably make an early diagnosis.
And when it comes to early detection, are we taking up these opportunities seriously to go and do regular checkups? Or what is the Kenyan public like?
I think we have a lot to do to create awareness, because even with people with access, they don't go for their pap smears, they don't go for their mammograms, they don't go for their prostate cancer checks. So I think a lot of education and creation of awareness is called for, and also creation of access to people who cannot access this screening, as well as diagnostics, as well as treatment modalities for cancer.
And why would you say people don't go for that screening? Is it because it's seen as perhaps an uncomfortable or invasive kind of test?
I would say to a majority, lack of awareness, and then number two, cost issues. Many people cannot afford.
And, you know, speaking of cost, that has also been, you know, a major issue when it comes to treatment. Are we making any headway at all?
I think there's some great strides that have been made recently, probably in the last 5 years or so. For example, the equipping of the hospitals, of peripheral hospitals by the government will help, you know, simple things like ultrasounds make a diagnosis of malignancies, which are usually diagnosed too late. So there is, and what we've seen today, you know, very many cancer advocates coming up, creating awareness, free screening being done. So basically, I think a lot of change will be seen henceforth.
What urgent interventions yet remain to be taken by government?
Definitely creating access. Kenyatta National Hospital is the only center, for example, offering radiotherapy. So therefore the move of equipping four or so cancer centers is a very positive one, because some of these treatments, health patients have to go to hospital daily. If they live in Kwale, it's very difficult for women to come and live in Nairobi for 6 weeks, leaving their families.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, and does that also include professionals such as yourself, oncologists? How many are they in the country?
We have
how many skilled operators of these machines are there?
We have very few specialists, cancer specialists, but also that has rapidly changed as many people are coming back home to take up positions. Either, you know, cancer care is multidisciplinary, not only as medical oncologists and radiation specialists, but also as nutritionists, as counselors, as pain control specialists, as radiotherapy technicians. So we have to start somewhere. We just have to go with a bang and start these facilities, attract people to come back home and train as we do the job.
We, you know, food is always the big one, you know, and things that we consume. Somebody watching at home and saying, okay, so what could I possibly do that would drastically reduce my cancer risk? Maybe taking things out of the kitchen or perhaps pursuing a different lifestyle. What would your advice be for that?
I would say the first probably important step is to know every individual is at risk of cancer. That's the most important thing. So change your health-seeking behavior. Go for your annual check. Number two, of course, is be active. Physical activity helps a lot to reduce the risk. Stop smoking, reduce alcohol intake, avoid infections like human papillomavirus and HIV that are associated with certain malignancies, and definitely improve the diet. A healthy, balanced diet that has fruits, vegetables, some protein, as well as, you know, the lean red meat that is unprocessed and also, you know, the white meats, a balanced diet.
Balanced.
Yes.
And an annual checkup. Which I think we just don't do.
Exactly.
But thank you so much for your views.
Thank you for
so
having
much
me.
For enlightening us.
All right.
Dr. Gladwell Kiarie, who's a medical oncologist. We're taking a short break on Citizen Live at 9. We're back with more news. And, of course, our discussion on Opinion Court. Tonight, we have three political analysts in studio. They're going to battle it out with Professor Edward Kizengani on the biggest political stories of the week. You don't want to miss it. See you in a bit.